Hello. So for those who are watching this live session later, so we are going to to tell that today we are going to have live session with Dr. Mathis from Germany, who is neurosurgeon. So now we are waiting for him joining us. And while we are waiting, let's talk about what would you like to hear today. If you are going to ask something, so it's the best time to create the question inside your head. So in a few seconds, Dr. Georgios Mathis is going to join us. How are you guys? What are you expecting for today? Dr. Mathis is with us, but if it's there are some problems with connection. Dr. Mathis, just accept invitation. If you have some problems, you can write down in comments because I see you are with us, but for some reasons, you can't join us. There's no invitation. Okay.
Hello.
Hello.
I tried to use my laptop. It doesn't work out. I don't know why. So let's use the smartphone.
That's great news. I was just about starting worrying.
No. We have a date.
So, Dr. Mathis, please tell our viewers, our audience, about you. Tell us about your mission in Germany in clinic. So, you are neurosurgeon, isn't it?
I hope so. So, let me start a little bit in a different way. I'm coming from Greece, but I'm working in Germany. I finished the medical school in Greece, then the neurosurgical training in Greece. After my residency, I was for 6 months in New York in Weill Cornell Medical College. There's a very nice skull-based lab there. I would suggest you to visit it. It's really nice. And after that, I was for 12 months in Zurich, in the University Hospital of Zurich in Switzerland, in the Department of Neuroradiology. I wanted to learn treating aneurysms endovascularly back then. So I stayed there for 12 months. And after that, I came to Germany, unofficially in December 2013, officially in May 2014. And since 2018, I lead the pain and spasticity sector in my hospital in Cologne now.
Wow. I'm so amazed, really. About a conversation with such a great person you are, and such a long way to become a really neurosurgeon. I'm just amazed with this.
It's not a matter of greatness, it's a matter of dedication. Everybody can achieve what I have achieved and many more than that. You have to have commitment and dedication. This is everything.
Wow. And what about problems you faced with during your journey? What was the greatest problems? Maybe some difficulties to become neurosurgeon?
There are many difficulties, and this is why the whole journey is much more interesting. I'm coming from Greece. In Greece, there is not a huge tradition in neurosurgery. For example, Germany has a huge tradition in this field. There are many colleagues that are coming from Europe or from other continents to get trained here in Germany. In Greece, it's not like that. So no. You cannot get a really, really good education as a neurosurgeon. And if you want to see the whole spectrum of neurosurgery is not only putting screws in the spine or doing the epidural and subdural hematomas. Neurosurgery has many, many other facets. For example, function of neurosurgery, what I'm doing now in Cologne. Such things were hard to see or learn in Greece, and I assume in many other countries worldwide. So it's a matter of resources. There are always good mentors, and it's very, very important to have a good mentor to support you. But you have to have also the infrastructure. You have to have good hospitals, good equipment, and a very good education. This is not always the case in all countries. But once again, and I think this is the message, and the most important thing that I can tell you is that it doesn't matter where you are coming from, it doesn't matter what sort of infrastructures you have in your own country. If you want, really want to learn and achieve some things, you will find your way. It's only a matter of dedication, and you can do whatever you want.
I get it. And what about being a student? Did you start your studentship and you knew from the very start that you are going to be a neurosurgeon, or do you have some options maybe?
Well, I was unlucky enough to be a very good student at school. And in Greece, there is a tradition. We still have this tradition in Greece. If a student is really good, has to become a lawyer or has to become a doctor. So I went a doctor. I chose to become a doctor. But when I was in the medical school, I could not really say that I like so much neurosurgery or neurology or cardiology or something else. This is why near the end of my medical school, I tried to do many observerships in different departments, internal medicine, surgical departments, neurosurgery. And only then I thought, maybe neurosurgery is something for me. It's always intriguing to see how the brain is working. It is even more intriguing to see how you can change the function of the brain, how you can modulate the brain. So I thought, okay, I like this. I can work in the spine area. I can work in the brain area. I can do many, many things. Let's become a neurosurgeon. Of course, back then I didn't really know what neurosurgery is. It is much more complicated than I thought back then, but it's really rewarding.
And what about you told it's rewarding a lot? Are you talking about pleasure from work?
I'm talking about pleasure from work. This is the most important thing. Why? Because we spend the biggest number of hours per day in the hospital. This is our home. It doesn't sound good, but this is a reality. So if you're going to stay 10 or 12 hours per day in a hospital, at least you will have to enjoy it. But if you have to have a normal personal life, this is another issue. And if you are a woman, it is even more difficult. This is the reality. But I must say, I know many colleagues, female colleagues, that can perfectly combine both of them, the private life and the professional life. But it depends on your goals. If you want to follow an academic career, then it's really, really hard to combine it with a good personal or family life. If you want to do it, you have to have a partner who is going to support you all the way. And the way is a long way. It's not an easy decision. So neurosurgery is a difficult specialty. It requires dedication and much time. If you want parallel to have an academic career and do the clinical work, then you have to devote your whole time in this thing. If it works it, I don't know. For me, yes, but maybe not for everybody.
Yeah, as you told, really, I agree. And we have a comment from Christos Tsagaris, our Greece.
I saw it.
Greece friend.
Hi, Christos.
Hello, Christos. Nice to see you today. Okay, and you know, Dr. Matis, in Ukraine, during our classes, our professors tell us the same things, and really, in some ways, I agree with that, and I believe that everything can be combined in this life, but it depends on a person's ambitions and wishes. So
priorities.
Yes.
I had many friends when I was in the medical school who were really good students. Some of them were even better than me. And I asked them, okay, we're finishing the medical school now. Which specialty will you choose? What do you want to become? Do you want to become an orthopedic surgeon? You want to become a cardiologist? And some of them told me, no, I want to become a microbiologist. And I told them, okay, but why you are so good student? Why do you want to become a microbiologist? And the answer was, because I want to have a normal personal life. So this is also a trap. If you are a good medical student or if you are a good resident, that does not necessarily mean that you have to pick up a neurosurgical career. You can try something else. You can also be very good in another specialty.
Mm-hmm. Yes, I suppose I should think about it. And what about your interesting clinical cases during your practice?
This is the best part of my job, exactly what I'm doing here in this hospital now. I'm working in the Department of Stereotactic and Functional Neurosurgery. This is actually a small part of the neurosurgery, but we see many patients and we have accumulated a huge experience. I'm treating patients with chronic pain or with spasticity, but to be honest, I prefer the chronic pain patients because it's much more rewarding. People are coming with pain and they are living with much less pain. I wouldn't say without pain. This is really difficult to do, but with much less pain. And I'm seeing now that with us, there is also one patient of us here who is watching this interview. And this makes me really glad. Don't get me wrong. You cannot help all patients. It's not possible. We are not gods, but we can try our best with the existing technology that we have, with the existing knowledge that we have, to bring the best. It doesn't always work. What I'm doing is implanting leads in the spinal column or implanting medical pumps. This is a good therapy if the indication is good, but even if the indication is good, not all patients benefit from it. And this should be clear from the very beginning. This is something the colleagues should know. If a neurologist is referring a patient to us, the neurologist should know that it could not work out for this patient. 80% of the patients are satisfied with our therapies, but there's always this 20%. And if you are a patient and you are not satisfied, if you belong to this 20%, for you, this is 100%. This is why we have to stay humble. Even though we are good at it, we have to stay humble because we see many patients that we cannot help. And the feeling is not good for a physician if a patient is coming to us and we cannot help him or her.
Yeah, unfortunately, doctors aren't gods. And we are just humans. We are just people, and we can only do what we can, even though.
Yeah, but sometimes this is good enough. I have met many people, not only meds in other fields as well, who are not doing what they are really can. So for me, the goal is to do my best always and then wait to see the results. In the majority of cases, the results are really good. Sometimes they are not good, but we have to live with that and we have to be strong and work even more and help even more patients. You must accept it. You cannot help everybody. But this is the real life as well. You cannot help everybody in the real life.
Yes, yes, that's what I'm talking about. What about dealing with stress during work? Have you ever had some cases when you just have to put all your emotions inside your fist and just to do something really scary or really stressful for you?
The majority of cases are pretty simple cases, what I'm doing. The problem is that we are getting referrals from other colleagues, patients that have chronic pain since 20 years, and the anatomy of the spine is not optimal. Then we can have some problems, and we notice that in the operating room. And then we say, okay, should we go ahead? Should we stop? Such problems could arise, but if you are doing these surgeries every day and you are doing only these operations for many, many years, then I would say fear is minimized, but respect is always there. We have always respect for the potential complications, and for us, complications are the nerve injuries. If we're going to injure the spinal cord or the spinal nerves, we have a huge respect. We're really careful, but I wouldn't say we have fear. I'm here since 2014, so almost 7-8 years now. I have performed over 4,000 surgeries. And even though the number might sound big, I'm not feeling perfect at it. I believe that I can become even better in the future.
Yeah, they say there is no border for self-perfection.
We should still keep working on our surgical technique, on studying, on looking around to see what there's new. There are always new things in medicine, in neurosurgery, and in functional neurosurgery. And this is one of the advantages of this field. Every 6 months, we have a new technology. We have new stimulation algorithms, we have new leads, we have new neurostimulators. There are many, many things, but pain, at least, is not that simple. It's not about the somatic reaction of the body. There are cognitive factors, emotional factors, psychological factors. This is why if you want to treat a patient, you cannot treat only the somatic problem. You cannot treat only the body. You need to treat the person as an entirety. And this is why you need the teamwork. You need psychologists, neurologists, physiotherapists, and so many other colleagues. Otherwise, you are not going to have good results. And pain is also a philosophical issue. I'm coming from Greece. I like philosophy. And I think neurosurgery, or at least functional neurosurgery, can meet philosophy. And we can learn many things from philosophy. But it's a complicated thing. In other areas of neurosurgery, it's more easy. You have an aneurysm, you can see it, you can clip it, or you can treat it in an endovascular way. But you have something objective, you can see it. If you are treating patients with chronic pain, you cannot see the pain. You cannot measure the pain objectively. You can always ask, we have this scale from 0 till 10, 0 no pain, 10 pain, which is really strong. But we cannot really be sure about it. And to be honest, there are also patients that are trying to use their pain to get other benefits from the state. And this is another problem. But this is also a big problem, because if the patients are not satisfied because we want to achieve something different, it's not about pain relief, then our results don't seem to be good. And this is not fair for us and for the therapy.
Interesting. You know, I saw neurosurgeons in hospitals in Chernivtsi, and you know, there is something similar between you and them. So I suppose neurosurgeons should have such a great calmness inside, just ability to face with stress and to calm down the patient, maybe if he's worrying about the future operation. And you know, really about operations that should be in future, have you ever met have you ever had patients that needed operations, but they were so scary about this that they just decided to refuse to have the operation? What are you doing usually with these patients?
Calmness, you mentioned the word calmness. Calmness is something that we should all have. All people should have it, not only the physicians. And for the physicians, not only the neurosurgeons. All physicians should be calm because... like a priest, we're not only physician, we're the psychologist, we are the priest, we're many things at the same time. You have to be calm. But I have met many colleagues, many neurosurgeons as well, who are not calm at all, and they saw it. So you, neurosurgeons are humans. So every human being has some positive aspects, some negative aspects, neurosurgeons as well. We are trying to be calm. This is not always possible. But the patients can notice that. They are feeling that. And if they are speaking with a patient who is calm, they are more attached to this physician and they want to get a surgery. There are always patients when they get informed about the possible risks that are saying, this sounds risky, I would not like to have this operation. If you speak with the majority of them and you explain them the risks, how frequent is this risk, and the alternative options, what the patient can do. If not accepting this therapy, then most of them in the end are going to say, okay, we're going to have this therapy. For me, it's more easy because I'm always the last physician that the patients are coming to. Patients with pain are visiting the general practitioner, a neurologist, an orthopedic surgeon, a neurosurgeon, a general neurosurgeon. And when all these colleagues cannot offer anything more, only then these patients are coming to me. So I'm the last hope. And they are prepared, mentally at least, to accept everything. So I'm lucky there. I don't have to fight with the patients to convince them that an operation is good for them. Most of them are coming and saying, please operate on
us. Yeah. Oh, I get it. And have you noticed the difference between medicine in Germany and in the United States, in Switzerland? So you told that you had some practice abroad. And what can you say about it?
This was a really good lesson for me because I saw how the physicians are acting in different countries, how the patients are acting in different countries, how the hospitals are structured and how the hospitals are acting there, and how the healthcare systems are structured in all these countries. And I must say that in countries like Greece, Spain, Italy, the relationship between a physician and patient is much, much better as a rule. It's more personal. The patient are feeling well. The physician is taking time to speak with the patients, can understand their emotions as well. This is really important. In other countries, in Switzerland, for example, or in the United States, the majority of colleagues see the patients as machines. You have a machine. The machine is not working. Which part of the machine should we change? They are not seeing people. They are seeing machines. This is a huge difference. I saw colleagues in the United States who immediately after the operation, they wanted to write down the data of the patient so they could be 100% sure that they are going to get paid from this patient. In Greece, after the operation, or in Germany, we're going directly to the patient after the operation, say, okay, how are you? How are you doing? Do you have pain? It is a totally different mentality. Please don't get me wrong. There are also many colleagues in the United States, in Switzerland, in all countries who are acting differently, that they have a very good relationship with the patients. They are trying to understand the patient, but the majority of them are money-oriented. In this, you can tell it. In the United States, it's much worse. In Switzerland, because it's also a private system, a private healthcare system, is going this way as well. In Germany, we have a social state, so the government is paying for the hospitals and in part the patients. This is why we have, at least till now, the possibility to spend much more time by the patients. So there are differences, and if you are a medical student, maybe it's a good idea to spend 1 week in 2 or 3 different countries. 1 week is enough to understand what's going on. You don't need much more time. And then to decide for yourself if you can work in such an environment. There are people who don't have any problem with that. Say, okay, the first call should be money. Let's go to the United States. Let's get these USMLE examinations. Let's start working the USA so we can get money. There are other physicians, and mainly women, must admit it, that as a first priority have the patient. They want to treat the patient in the best possible way. And they don't care about money. There is also this type of colleagues. In my opinion, you should be somewhere in the middle of these two. The edges are never good. You have to find the position somewhere between being extremely money-oriented and extremely patient-oriented. Because in doing so, you can benefit yourself. Don't forget, medicine is also a job. We have to get money. We have to live with this money. We have to support our family with this money. It's not only a hobby, but then you can have the you can help the patient, and you can help your hospital and your healthcare system. Because if the healthcare system collapses, then the patients are not going to get any help. So you have to see the big picture. It's not about yourself only. It's not about your hospital only. It's about the whole country you are living and working in. And you have to have this responsibility to always think, okay, it's a medical decision, but we have to take it into consideration the financial aspects as well of our decisions. We are responsible for that. We cannot tell them we are physicians, we don't care about money. If you have 3 options, you have to choose the best option that is good for the patient, at the same time is good for the healthcare system. It's not easy, but as you get older, as you accumulate more experience, you will see that the decisions are made really easy. In the beginning, it looks really difficult, but after that, after 2, 3, 4 years working as a consultant, because as a resident is completely different, but after the first 2 or 3 years working as a consultant, you will see that the decisions come automatically. And I think this is right. This is the right thing to do.
Mm-hmm. You told that we have to have the attitude to the patient like to the human, not to the machine. Yeah, but what about situations when you have to treat your relatives or acquaintance people? So somebody you know, that somebody who you who you are close to. What about this situation? Do we still have to treat this patient not forgetting about our emotions, or opposite, we have to treat them more distantly from our heart?
You cannot forget your emotions. It's not possible. We are humans. We are made out of emotions. You cannot forget them. But you will have to deal with that at some point in your career. You will always have a family member or a very close friend who is going to need you. So for me, the decision is simple. If I know that I'm good at something and I can do it, I would treat my father or my mother. I wouldn't say, oh, he's my father, she's my mother, I'm not going to do anything. If I know that I'm good at it, I'm going to do it. But I don't think this is a big problem. It depends on your experience, on the field, and of course on your emotions, on your personality. Not all physicians are the same. But it's not a really easy decision, but you have to feel good. If you're feeling good with yourself, if you know I can do it, I have experience, then who would pay much more attention to your father, to your mother, than yourself?
Thank you. So you will treat them and like just any other patient, you will not have any portion of maybe fear or like any other.
I will have the same amount of fear as when I operate on other patients. All humans have the same value. My father has not greater value as a human being as all of the other patients that I'm treating. So if I dare to operate on people that I hardly know, on strangers, and I know I can do it well, then I would definitely treat my father or my mother as well.
Interesting. Really, I'm excited. I wish every doctor will be like you in this field.
But there is one rule. When the physicians are treating their family members or their closest friends, something is always going wrong. I don't know why.
Yes, I'm talking about it because we are excited, we are scary. It's normal thing.
I don't think this I cannot explain it scientifically, but I don't think this depends on us. All these complications that are coming, I don't think they are related to us. Some strange things always happen. There can be organizational things. They don't have to be associated with a surgery or with medicine. It could be organizational problem. For example, you plan an operation and then there are strikes. You cannot operate. Or in Germany, it's pretty frequent. People are fighting bombs here. When they are trying to construct new buildings, they are digging into the ground. They are fighting many bombs from the Second World War. This is pretty frequent situation here in Germany. And sometimes you have to evacuate a big area if you want to disarm this bomb. And there were operations that we could not perform because of this reason. We had to empty the hospital, to evacuate the hospital. So strange things can always happen. This is life. This is why it is interesting. Otherwise, it would be boring, I think. But once again, if you're believing in yourself, if you know that you can do it, you should do it.
At first, I thought that you were talking about bomb, not in the real meaning of the bomb.
But more real. It's not possible. It's a real bomb.
Wow. So scary. I didn't hear about this in Ukraine so often that you are talking about this in German.
Don't forget, during the Second World War, I work in Cologne. Cologne is located in the western part of Germany, so it's near the borders with France, Luxembourg, or Belgium. So all the fighter aircrafts from United Kingdom or from the American ones were coming here in Cologne. So we were. So the city was the first city to attack. And I don't know if it's good or bad, many of those bombs back then did not explode. So the quality was not that good back then. It's a good and a bad thing. And we find them all over the place here in Cologne. So this, every day we hear in this area, a new bomb was found. So this is normal for us. When I first came in Germany, I thought, oh, where am I coming here? What is that? But now it is routine.
Why did you choose Cologne for your medical practice? Was it for reason or just cases, situations in life lead you?
There are two reasons. The first reason was that Cologne is a very open city for foreigners. So if you are living in this city, you are feeling free, you don't have any problems. There are so many foreigners here coming from Greece, from Turkey, from Spain, Italy, from all over the world. So actually, Cologne is like New York. There are so many people from other countries. So you can live here without any problems. The second reason was that back then, 2013, I met my mentor, Dr. Koulouzakis, who was working then in the university hospital, and he was looking for help. Back then, I didn't speak any German. Now my German is pretty bad as well, but at least I can communicate in some to some degree with the patients. But I didn't know anything about functional neurosurgery back then. And he invited me here. I saw the department. So in comparison to the Greek departments, it was like a palace. So I said, okay, it looks really good. I would like to work here. I would like to learn all these surgeries and perform them on my own in the future. And then I walked a little bit in the city. I saw how is the city, what type of people are living here. And the whole thing was good enough for me to say, okay, I leave Greece and I'm going to Germany. But I must also say the decision to leave Greece was not that difficult because I already have lived in Switzerland for 12 months. I was in the United States for 6 months. So this was a test drive for me. I saw that I can live outside Greece. Germany has a huge tradition in neurosurgery and in functional neurosurgery. My hospital here was the first hospital in Germany where all these operations took place, the functional neurosurgical operations. The tradition is huge, and this is why for me it's an honor to be able to work here and hopefully write a new tradition. We'll see.
We'll see. Actually, I expected to hear an amazing love story that you met your future wife and that... That's why you decided to move to Cologne.
When I moved to Cologne, I was 37 years old. I was married and I had two children. So the decision was not that easy. And my wife was not satisfied with this decision. I must tell you, this is why I told you, if you want to combine the professional life with the private one, it's not that easy. The decisions are difficult. And this is really important to have the support of your wife or of your husband if you want to try different things. For me, the easiest way would be to stay in Greece. I already had a position in a private hospital there. I could work there, so it was not a matter of money. And maybe there I could get even more money than here in Germany, in the private sector. But back then, and still, I have other priorities.
Mm-hmm.
And I see somebody is asking, what are those traditions in Germany? So all these operations started here in Germany. There are 3-4 big schools worldwide in neurosurgery. One of them is the German school. Back then, in 1960, 70, there were many colleagues back then who did really innovative things in neurosurgery, in aneurysms, in functional neurosurgery as well. And don't forget, Germany has a population of 80 million people. That means many patients. So there were colleagues who had many patients and they got a huge experience during all these operations. They wrote amazing books in German. They published many articles most of them in German, some of them also in English. And the education of the residents was, till now at least, pretty good, or much better than in other countries. So if you finish your residency here in Germany, in a normal hospital, you're going to be in a position to operate on your own many, many things. This is not the case in other countries, and this is the advantage of this country.
Thank you so much for your answer. And tell us about your daily routine. So you told that you are spending much time in hospital. What about your daily routine? So when do you wake up usually, and when do you usually come home?
It's like the army. I wake up at 5 o'clock in the morning, or when I'm delayed at 5:30, but usually at 5 o'clock. I am at the hospital at 6:30 in the morning, and I stay here usually at least till 6:30 in the evening.
Wow, 6:30 a.m. you are in the hospital. Amazing. So we have another question.
Germany.
Germany, amazingly. Is Germany better than United States for neurosurgery residency?
This is a difficult question because I was not a resident in the United States. I was also not a resident here in Germany, but at least I can see here what the residents are doing. I believe if you want to stay in the United States after the residency, then the best option is to do the residency in the United States. If you want, after the residency, to go back to Europe, for example, to stay permanently there, then I wouldn't go to the United States, because if you go there, you have to work really hard, and after that, you won't come back to Europe.
Interestingly.
And it's not that easy to become a neurosurgeon in the United States. You have to give these USMLE exams, and even if you have really good grades, nobody can guarantee you that you're going to get a position for a neurosurgical residency. You can end up doing microbiology. I don't have anything against microbiology. It's not an example. But you don't have any guarantee. You can have very good grades, but still you are not getting a position for a neurosurgical position. Why? Because neurosurgeons in the United States are earning really much money, and this is why they are trying to limit the positions of the residents. And for these open positions, they are usually getting colleagues from the United States, not from abroad. There are always exceptions, of course. If you really want it, you should try it, but it's difficult. You should know that from the very beginning. On the other side, if you already know that you are going to stay in Europe for the rest of your life, then I think you should do your residency in Europe. The residency in Germany is good. I think in the United Kingdom, for example, is always good. But this depends also on the specialty. For neurosurgery in Europe, I would go to Germany.
Interestingly. And Dr. Mattis, do you have your work only in the practical field? Or maybe you have the connection with universities, giving the lectures, or having classes with students, kind of that?
This is a difficult question, because this shows how the German system is also working. Now I'm a senior consultant, I'm not a resident. So I spent, let's say, 60% of my time for organizational issues, 30% of the time for clinical issues, operations, for example. So I'm not operating that much anymore. After 4,000 surgeries, I thought it's time to leave my colleagues do some work here to get some experience. We have a team who's performing these surgeries. I'm not alone. You need a team. So the colleagues have the opportunity to operate themselves now. And if they need me, I'm always there. I can always jump over and help. academic work at this time, at this time point, is not done because we don't have the time. I'm hoping in the next years that we are going to be able to do much more academic things. And academic things means publications in high impact factor journals. You know already that I'm really active on social media. I'm doing many things for medical students and for residents. Whenever somebody is asking for a lecture, I always say yes. It's a great joy for me to participate in such things because the students and the residents are our future. I'm hoping that they're becoming much, much better than we are now. And it's good to gain from our experience now at the early stages, not when they are 50 years old.
Actually, we didn't even expect that you will accept our invitation to live session, because really neurosurgeons and from Germany, so we are really pleased for accepting our interview invitation.
I'm very happy to participate. It's an honor for me as well. If I can help in any way, I'm glad to do it.
Thank you so much. And if maybe somebody from the audience would like to ask a question to Dr. Matis, so I am sure he is open for your questions, guys. Don't be shy. And I suppose if you would like, guys, you can ask Dr. Matis a question in direct messages. I suppose he will also answer it.
Most of them are already connected with me on social media, so they can reach out whenever they want.
Yeah, that's a really pleasure. And Dr. Matis, oh, yes. Thank you. Oh, Greece.
Yeah, in Greek as well. Greeks are everywhere.
Yeah, like Ukrainians.
I think it's the same for all nations, but we like to say it only for ourselves.
Dr. Matis, what about your wife? Is she also a doctor?
Unfortunately, yes. She has studied respiratory medicine and she specialized in the intensive care unit. And this is another problem. You should take this into consideration as well. If you want to devote yourself to your professional life and you want to have also personal life, then it's really hard to get married to a physician.
Yeah.
You should be very wise when choosing. It is real, it is possible. You can combine it, but it's difficult. Two physicians in one family, it's a very difficult combination.
So you recommend to have a partner who isn't in medicine?
Yes, because in the end, when you're getting back home at 7 or 8 o'clock in the evening, if you have a husband, for example, for you, who is also a physician, you will end up discussing medical things. And our brain needs other thoughts as well, not only medicine. Otherwise, you cannot function very well.
On the other hand, you can have a person who can understand you if you are worrying about something, who can recommend you how you can do in any or other case.
This is the positive aspect. There are also positive aspects, but this depends on the person. But my suggestion is to think twice about it because it's really important. It's true. A physician can understand you perfectly well. You can, she or he can understand what types of problems you have, what are your worries. This is true. On the other hand, you should consider the fact that more or less you are going to speak your whole life about medical things, even if you stop working when you are 65 or 67 years old. If it's something that that you like, well, go ahead.
Thank you. And we have the question, what advice would you give to your younger self?
Nice question. Difficult one. Just try. You don't have anything to lose. Just try. In your personal life and in your professional life. These two must run in a parallel way. You cannot forget completely your personal life. You cannot forget your professional life as well. But you have to take the risk. You have to take the chances and you have to keep trying. Even if you fail, if you succeed, it's not the end of the world. And we are only living once.
You're right. And as they say, it's much better to try to do and to regret that you have done than regret that you haven't done.
Exactly. So, I agree completely.
Yes. So I suppose we can come to the end. So thank you so much for such a great conversation, such a great advice that you have given. Yes, it's really great. I can't even make up other words, really. I suppose everybody have a large portion of things to think about after this conversation. And everybody, if you will have a question in future about neurosurgery or in about medicine in general, and even in about personal life, I suppose you can ask Dr. Madis, and really great people.
But your
I suppose
so thank you very much.
There was some problems, so we didn't hear, at least me, I didn't hear your last phrase.
So I can repeat it. Advice about your personal life, maybe I'm not the best person to do it. But if you need advice about functional neurosurgery and neuromodulation, I can certainly help. Thank you very much.
Thank you so much. So I don't know if I can, you wish to have a good day, because in Ukraine we don't wish a good day or good night or good shift to doctors, because they believe that something goes wrong. So I don't know. Just thank you so
Let's
much.
Let's get back to work. It's enough. The work is waiting.
Yeah. So have a nice work.
Thank you very much. Stay safe. Thank you very much. Bye-bye.
So much. Bye.
Bye.